Okay, so I think we can start. I'm going to talk about algebras in programming and exactly what do we mean when we're using the word algebra. My name is Harry Laoulakos. You can follow me at Harry Lau in Twitter. I'm a senior Scala consultant. I'm a lot into functional programming, but I'm more into the practical side of functional programming. So in my opinion, everything has a cost. So by using functional programming and these kind of techniques, there is a benefit, but there is also a cost. Usually the cost is about readability and how a team can understand these concepts. In my opinion, the benefits are always big enough to make them worth it. Also, I would like to apologize. I'm feeling a little bit sick today, so my energy levels are a bit low. Apologies for that. So this talk is better suited for absolute beginners in Scala or in functional programming. So it's not necessary to know Scala. The syntax is really light in this talk, but in any case, you should just focus on semantics and try to understand the concepts behind it. And the main goal is to build the vocabulary to communicate with fellow programmers. This talk touches some mathematical concepts, but really doesn't go too deep. So the mathematical definitions are somehow incomplete. You can find the slides at this URL. It's www.harrylau.com/slides/algebrasinprogramming.pdf. I'm waiting. Okay. So first of all, algebra is a term used to describe an area of mathematics or multiple areas of mathematics. So there is an elementary algebra, abstract algebra, linear algebra, Boolean algebra, commutative algebra, homological algebra, and even more, universal algebra, algebraic number theory, algebraic geometry, algebraic combinatorics, relational algebra. So I think by now it's pretty clear that, yeah, by algebra we are meaning many things. Also, there are not only areas, but there are also some mathematical structures are called algebras. So in category theory, there is F algebra, F coalgebra, T algebra. So yeah, when we are talking about algebra, it is not necessarily the same thing or even similar things. That's the main point here. So in programming, we are using the word algebra for the following things. There are algebraic data types, or ADTs, generalized algebraic data types, or GADTs. We are talking about tagless final algebra, or free monads algebra, or recursion schemes algebra. This list is not complete, and there are more usage of the words algebra, like algebraic effects, which is a huge topic. And in this talk, it's going to be just the surface of these algebras, and they are not going to go very deep. So ADT, algebraic data type. ADT is a composite type of product types, or else stacked unions, and sum types, or else coproduct or unions. Sometimes the problem is just that we just don't know the name of a simple thing. So keep in mind that product types have also another name, it's called tagged union. Sum types can be called either coproduct or unions. I will not mention the other names in this talk anymore, just I'm going to mention product types and sum types. But keep in mind that, yeah, they have also other names. You might see them in blog posts or somewhere else with different names. So product type. Product type can be a case class, it can be a tuple, or it can be an H list. All of them are different encodings of the same principle. So let's see the simplest product type is a case class where a user has an ID, it's a long, or a string as a username. So in product types, you should think about and. So the user has an ID and a username. So it's the sum of multiple types. So the sum type can be either a sealed trait or a coproduct. Again, this coproduct in shapeless. These things represent the same type, the sum type. It's a different encoding for the same thing. So in Scala, this is a way we are encoding some type. It's a sealed trait of animal, a case class which extends an animal, and a case dog that extends an animal. So I don't know if anyone here doesn't know about trait. Trait is like an interface in Java, something like that. And sealed trait is, I don't know if anyone doesn't know. Everyone knows about sealed traits? Okay, I guess yes. So yeah, maybe I can say that a sealed modifier is just defines that all the inheriting templates must be defined in the same source file. Okay, so when you are presenting with a sum type, you should think of four. So an animal can be either a cat or a dog. Okay, so in Scala, in this encoding, we are using inheritance, but sometimes it's a bit different than inheritance. So there are ADTs in Rust, which Rust doesn't have inheritance. And also in Scala 3, sometimes are encoded without inheritance. So you saw in the previous example that cat extends an animal, dog extends an animal. But it's not about inheritance, it's about the encoding of some types. So I've mentioned Rust. Let's give the same example in Rust. So a product type is a struct that has an ID, a number, and a string, a name. And the sum type is the animal. It's an enumeration of animal, can be a cat or a dog. And also in Scala 3, we're gonna have union types. Which is a pipe symbol where an animal can be a cat or a dog. We don't even have to define type aliases. We can just say in an argument that A can be a cat or a dog. Also in Scala 3, another encoding can be enumeration. So the enum concept in Scala 3 is general enough to support ADTs. So in this example, we are seeing an enumeration of color, which can be either red, green, blue, or mix. And let's see some very common ADTs which everyone is using, like option or either. And option is a sealed trait of option, can be sum of value. Some can have a value A, or none that doesn't have a value. You can ignore the plus sign. It just notes that the type variable can be covariant. And either is more or less, I say more or less because the actual implementation is a sealed abstract class. But okay, we can say it's a sealed trait of either. It's left or right. Left of value A or right of value B, of type B. So ADTs, they can be parameterized, type parameterized. When it's about a product type, think about N. When it's a sum type, think or. It can be one thing or the other. So JDTs, generalized algebraic data type, which is a generalization of parametric algebraic data types. So this is an example of a JDT, we have a sealed expression of type T, a case class numeric of integer, which extends the expression of integer, case class bool of a b boolean, which extends an expression of boolean, and so on. Add of two expressions of integer, which extend an expression of integer, and multiplication, and also equal. The case class of equal is type parameterized against A, so can be any expression. So when we have this function that takes an expression of T and returns the T, and then again we pattern match, the important thing is to notice here that the result type can be either integer or boolean depending on the expression. So if it's a numeric, it returns the integer, the return type is integer. If it's a bool of b, it's a b. If it's an addition, it just evaluates the additions and returns the addition or the multiplication, also about the equal. So we can have expressions like this. We take the addition of numeric 1, numeric 2, and then we multiply with a numeric 4. And we take the numeric 12, and then we can have the equality of those two expressions and the results when we evaluate it's true. So what's the advantage of this? I mean, okay. The advantage is that we can have type-safe business logic and type-safe DSLs, just like the previous example. Okay, everything is nice, but where is the algebra? I mean, in high school, we all did algebra and it was something different. So let's say we have a vehicle type that can be either a car or a motor. So how many vehicle types are there? Two, yeah, there are two. So let's say we have some type color that can be either red, yellow, or blue. So how many colors are there? Three. Yeah, it's simple. So also in elementary algebra, the sum is the result of addition. So here you see that in the sum type, we have like two vehicle types or three colors. So let's see the product type. Let's say we have a product vehicle that has a vehicle type and color. So how many vehicles are there if there are two vehicle types and three colors? Six. It's two times three, six. So let's say we enrich a little bit the vehicle and has a vehicle type. There are two vehicle types, three colors, and a boolean if it's used, if it's a second-hand vehicle or not. So how many vehicles are there? Two times three times two. Yeah, just a multiplication. So also in high school algebra, the product is the result of multiplication. So I think you start seeing the correspondence and the analogy with product types and sum types. So as in ADTs, as in elementary algebra, sum is the result of addition, and product is the result of multiplication. So let's see the function. In Scala, function can be a type. So all these three examples are valid syntax. So we can have def like of color, can be boolean, or we can encode it as val like color to boolean, or even we can have it as its own type. So if the color is red, it can have it can be either true or false, the like function. If the color is yellow, it can be true or false. And if the color is blue, it can be true or false. So how many different implementations are there? So there can be like, for the first case, we can have two implementations. For the second case, we can have two implementations. For the third, two. So it's three, two to the exponent of three. Does this make sense, or does anyone have any question about this? Yeah. Okay. So let's see a second example. So we have a silk trade country. This is a sum type that can be one of those five countries, France or UK, or Germany or Japan or USA. And let's say we have 20 brands. So we have a second sum type brand that can be one of those 20 brands. And we have the function is produced. Takes as an argument a brand that has 20 implementations and country that has 5 implementations. So in case of brand one, we can have one of those 5 results. In case of brand two, we can have one of those 5 results, and so on. So the implementations are 5 times 5 times 5, 20 times. Again, it's 5 to the exponent of 20. So I just copied this from a blog post about category theory that says in mathematical literature, the function object or the eternal home object between two objects, A and B, are often called to the exponential and denoted B to the exponent of A. So in simpler terms, when we have a function function f from A to B, this corresponds to the exponential B to the exponent of A. So let's see a practical example. Okay, this is all good, but where can I use this? I mean, let's do some high school algebra. So let's say we have this expression. So we have a function. So this is a comp. This is a lot of functions. So let me try to say it in words. So we have a function that comes from that it has as an argument another function A to C, and the result type is another function that its argument is a function from B to C. And it's a result type C. So let's try to do the algebra on this thing. So we show that a function takes the result type and the exponent is the argument. So I'm just changing right and left, and the argument I'm putting to the exponent. So I'm just doing this thing all along. So I leave the right exponent as it is. I just take the function and I transform it to an exponent. I do the same thing. So right now I'm just having exponents. So it's C to the exponent of C to the exponent B. And then the exponent is again to the exponent of C and A. So by high school algebra, I just take the exponent, I multiply it. So it's C to the exponent CB times C to the exponent of A. And then I can just, since the base in the exponent is the same, I can just add the exponents. And now I just I do the other side transformation. So this corresponds to either A or B to C. So this is a much more simpler expression than the first one, which is equivalent. I never do this kind of things when I program, but this is just an example of how you can use this algebraic equivalences. Okay. So there are more algebras. We finish with algebraic data types. And in programming, sometimes you might hear about tagless final algebra or free monads algebra. So there is a lot of discussion in the Scala functional community about tagless final versus free monads. It is a big topic. Comparison of this is out of scope for this talk. But let's try to find out what algebra mean in this context. So I'm just taking a random blog post. I have the link in the notes. And I'm just copying stuff from there. So this is some code from the blog post. So it says about a trait, database algebra, that has a type constructor f and a type t, and three functions. They are not abstract functions. Create takes an argument of t and returns an f of boolean. Read takes an argument of long and returns an f of either of database 0 or t. And delete takes an id of long that returns an f of either database or unit. And also I'm copying some text from the blog post. It says tagless final L-coded algebras. So I guess this is an algebra. Okay. And again, from the same blog post, I go to the part about free monads, and it says, seal trait, DB-free algebra T of T, case class. So I see that the encoding of the functions here are as an ADT, okay, instead of functions. It says, create T extends DB-free algebra T, read of type T, that takes as an argument of long, returns a DB free algebra T, and delete the same. And some text from this blog post says we need to create some interpreters to interpret our algebra into actions. So from these things, I can more or less, we'll create some interpreters. So I can more or less deduct that, okay, this looks like the interpreter pattern. So the interpreter pattern, we need to have a grammar for a simple language and then just provide interpretations for it. So my understanding is that in free monad tagless final, the grammar in the interpreter pattern, design pattern, is just called algebra. Yeah. So I mentioned about category theory. But what is category theory? So here are some definitions. The first one is from Wikipedia. It says that it formalizes mathematical structure and its concepts in terms of a labeled direct graph. Okay, it's a graph called a category, whose nodes are called objects, and labeled directed edges are called arrows or morphisms. Okay, so category theory, just a graph. From another definition, it says that it's the mathematics of mathematics. Another definition in the internet says it's the science of composition and abstraction, or the mathematics behind functional programming. So in the context of category theory, there is also used the word algebra. So we have F algebra, F coalgebra, free algebra, co-free algebra, and more, I guess, but okay. So what is an algebra in general? It's if we have a set of A and some operator. Operator can be a unary, so we can have a unary operator from A to A, or a binary operator from A, comma A to A, or an n-ary operator, how many A's to A. So what about the sequence of A to A? Let's say we want to, I don't know, to calculate the sum of A's, or the maximum or minimum. So what about the option of A? So I guess we can generalize and say, instead of sequence of A to A or option, F to A to A. So F, when we have an algebra of F to A to A, and the F is also a functor, so I guess maybe someone here doesn't know what functor is. If you have done a little bit of Scala, you've seen option or list that have the method map that takes a higher order function. More or less, okay, without the mathematical rigor of it, everything that has a map is a functor and has to obey some laws. So option is a functor, list is a functor, future is a functor. Okay, so this is called an F algebra. So F algebra is a generalization of normal algebra. So we've seen in a couple of slides before that there is this thing co, like co-algebra or co-free. But what does it mean? So there is this complex in category theory that there is a duality. So the definition, again, is duality is a correspondence between the properties of category C and the dual properties of the opposite category. And so, since we saw that the first definition of category theory is that it's just a directed graph, we can just change the direction of the arrows. So if we have an F of A to A, if we reverse the arrows, we can say that the function for the type from A to F of A is a co-algebra. And algebras, F algebras and co-algebras are used in recursion schemes. What is a recursion scheme? The official definition is that it's a calculus for lazy functional programming based on a recursion operator associated with data type definitions. So in simpler terms, it's an advanced functional programming technique that moves the recursion to the type level. So if you are familiar with recursion, functions that are recursion, and you have recursive data types, with recursion schemes, you can move the recursion to the type level, and then if you provide F algebras and co-algebras, you can do things like fold and unfold. It's a huge topic, but I'm trying just to give a touch just the surface. So yeah, using F algebras and co-algebras. So it's a recursion scheme. It's if you have any code that is doing one, two, or three level recursion. I mean, I was in a code base and there was like three level recursion, which after that my mind couldn't work. I mean, it just stopped. If you transform this kind of complex recursive code to recursion scheme, you just move the complexity to the type level, and you just provide this implementation of F to A to A, and that's pretty much it. So yeah, we saw about ADTs and ADT and GADT, which is an analogy to elementary algebra, to high school algebra, can be sometimes, which has a correspondence to arithmetic addition, product type, which has a correspondence to arithmetic multiplication, function type, which has an analogy to exponential operation. We just presented free Monad algebra and tagless final algebra, which in essence is the grammar in the interpreter design pattern. And we saw a little bit about F algebras and F co-algebras. Again, this list is not a complete list of usage of the word algebra. Neither have we gone into deep about these topics. It's just a very simple presentation to get some sort of idea. And also when you are hearing about algebras, that they are not something, I don't know, if you read a blog post and you see the word F algebra, it's not something, just a function from F to A to A. Here are the references and some stuff so you can read more and learn more about these topics. And yeah, I think I finished early. That's it. Do you have any questions? Maybe you can wait for the microphone.
In Scala case classes, all extend product with serializable, and it is a sum type. Is this product related to this algebra, or is it something else?
Which I think it takes the name from this algebra. I think it provides some sort of helper class. I don't remember exactly, but it is related to the product in the product type. That's why it's named product. But its functionality is to provide some common functionality as extension of traits does in Scala.
Thank you for the talk. It's really interesting. Now you introduced the definition of algebra. I would like to know.
Can you speak a bit more louder? Because I cannot hear.
All right. You introduced the definition of algebra, and I would like to know, is that really, is there any usage of this algebra in the real world? Like what you did when you analyzed the function signature in a mathematical way.
For example, Tagle's final and free monads is a common way to do, like, to have, like, to provide your own algebra and then have to have an abstraction over grammar, algebra, and then have different kind of implementations. I mean, it's a common pattern even in object-oriented programming, the interpreter design pattern. So yeah, this is used everywhere. So the grammar is just called algebra. Also in free monads, the free algebra is defined in GADTs. So if you remember the example, you just provide some, and then you need to read more stuff to see how it's working. But yeah, these are stuff that you are gonna see and work every day if you start doing functional programming in Scala. Just, yeah.
I mean more about the mathematical part of the algebra. You make the multiplication on the functions, and in one of your previous slides, you have a very complicated type signature, and after a series of transformation using algebra, you have a simpler signature.
Yeah, this was an example just to demonstrate the equivalence of things. I mean, yeah, I don't know if you are stuck in a code base that has this kind of complex type signatures. Yes, I guess you can try to do it, but it's more about to say, okay, because when you are starting working with functional programming, the rest of the team are gonna say, okay, algebraic data type, algebraic data type. And then you say, okay, where is the algebra there? Why don't they say just data types? It's more about how to say, to present the vocabulary that, okay, there is some algebra, even high school algebra hidden behind this. And then you're gonna read the blog post about Tagle's final, you're gonna see, okay, algebra. Okay, where is the algebra? I mean, at least for me in the beginning was a bit, sometimes things are really simple, you just don't know how they are named. So just to present the name and just to demystify that, yeah, it's not something super mathematical, it's just a simple thing.
In one of the slides talking about generic algebra data types.
Yeah, I think I can go. Where was it? Here. This one?
Yeah, the slides after. Will this even compile? I think.
Yeah, compiled.
So the okay. Thank you.
Yeah, you just copy. It's super simple. Just copy it in a SCSI or somewhere in a worksheet, and you'll see that it's okay. It's working.
Thanks for the talk. Since you said it's just about the naming, something got me wondering, why is the dual of F algebra F coalgebra, but why the dual of free algebra is co-free algebra, not free coalgebra?
Yeah, it's because free, I don't know, I need to read what's happening. I haven't used co-free algebras, only free. It just when you are reading something, you see the term co, it's just the duality. So, I mean, if you are starting reading category theory, very soon you realize that you are not a mathematician. But maybe you are, but I am not. So things and the notation becomes really complex and really difficult. I mean, this is a big obstacle for programmers to start understanding this kind of things. But okay, even if you don't understand every notation or every theorem or whatever, okay, you can think in abstract, okay, it's a directed graph, nothing else. I mean, all the books, all the blog posts, just graphs. So when it's code, it's just the opposite graph, you just change the arrows. I mean, you can understand that even if you don't get all the details. Yeah, I guess that's it. Thank you.